बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। टुडेज टॉपिक फॉर डिस्कशन इज बी लिम्फोसाइट एक्टिवेशन एंड द कॉम्प्लीमेंट सिस्टम। वी विल बी डूइंग दिस इन टू पार्ट्स। दिस लेक्चर इज वुड बी कन्फाइंड मोस्टली टू द बी लिम्फोसाइट एक्टिवेशन। सो द लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव फॉर दिस लेक्चर इज दैट बाई द एंड ऑफ दिस लेक्चर यू शुड बी एबल टू डिफाइन इम्यूनिटी एंड क्लासीफाई इट। Then describe the development of immune system, locate the lymphoid tissues in the human body, define antigen and antibody separately and precisely, describe in detail beta B cell activation, and describe the complement system and outline types of complement system. Now please be reminded that complement system we will be doing separately as well. So immunity, what is immunity? The ability of a human body to resist any organisms or those organisms that tend to damage the tissues is called as immunity. Now we have certain different types of immunity. For example, we have innate immunity, as the name shows. That is you have it already. That is innate, inbuilt in your system. And this innate immunity is the power of immunity, you can resist the damaging organisms and toxins. For example, what are the examples of these innate immunity? For example, if there is some antigen or certain antigenic thing or a virus or a bacteria or any molecule that is harmful for your body, so the body it has an innate system that it is going to respond to it. Now, how the body is going to respond to it? It is either through the phagocytosis of bacteria, that is eating up the bacteria. It would just eat up the bacteria or the virus, whatever it is. Then there would be a destruction of, if you, for example, swallow something that is damaging, for example, bacterial or viral things. So if you swallow it, your gastric juices, they are going to digest that invading organism. So this is inbuilt within your body. You don't have to work for it. This is the natural capability of the body. Then, for example, the resistance of the skin to invading organisms. Now your skin is protecting you all the day. Skin was not there, or it would not have functioned for the immunity. So we are exposed every day to so many toxins, antigenic viruses and bacteria, so we'd be having infections. Now there are certain diseases, for example, there are certain genetic developmental diseases in where the skin is not formed. So those babies, they usually die by second month. They cannot survive because of the septicemia they get, because of infections they get, because the skin is a natural barrier for all those viruses and bacteria that are usually present in the environment near to us. So one innate immunity is, you can count on the skin. Then you have in the blood, you have certain chemical compounds that attach to the foreign organisms or toxins and destroy them. So some of these things that are present already in your blood are lysozymes, which is a polysaccharide, a mucolytic polysaccharides that attacks bacteria and dissolves it, virtually dissolves it. Then you have basic polypeptides, which usually kill the gram-positive bacteria. And then you have the complement system, which is also a part of innate immunity, that whenever there is antigenic exposure of bacterial or virus particles or any foreign invading organism, so the complement system is activated, which then further would either take that thing out by phagocytosis or by any other material, would just get rid of that bacteria or viruses. So this is all what they all would come under the domain of innate immunity. Now you must know what is innate immunity, and you must know how your body is being protected by different mechanisms we have done from this damaging organisms or toxins through different mechanism already present in your body. So our innate immunity, it makes our bodies develop to resist certain
type of diseases, for example, virus diseases, viral diseases, or the diseases that are usually present in animals to be passed to us, and then a lot of other diseases. So that was innate immunity. Now coming to the acquired immunity. Now acquired immunity, I have written specific over here. It is adaptive immunity. The innate immunity was a more generalized form of immunity, but the acquired immunity is specific and it is adaptive immunity. And then acquired immunity is caused by special immune system that forms antibodies or activated lymphocytes that attack and destroy the specific invading organism or toxins. And this can be done by two types. For example, I have written over here, further it is classified into humoral immunity and cellular immunity. The humoral immunity is caused by the circulating antibodies which are being produced by the B cell. For example, we say na ki hamare itni antibodies hain, from where these antibodies come. These antibodies usually are made from the B cell. And then the cellular immunity, where the whole of the T cell, it becomes activated and acts to kill the bacteria. So in the T cell, we call it this as cellular immunity because whole of the T cell is activated, and the humoral immunity is because of B cell, and B cell itself would not go physically and fight the bacteria, rather it would produce a lot of antibodies, plasma cells, and these plasma cells would produce antibodies which would go and fight off the bacteria. So summarizing this slide, innate immunity, which is inbuilt into your system, and acquired, and which is more generalized, starting from the skin, your skin, your GI tract, your musculoskeletal system, and your different components within your blood, which would usually attack the any invading organism. And then you have the acquired immunity, which is made specific to a specific virus or a bacteria. Now you can see the development of the immune system. The development of the immune system is from a single cell, that is pluripotent hemopoietic stem cell. And this cell then, if either migrates into the thymus, would form T cells. That's why it be denoted by the alphabet T. And if it, why do we call these as B cells? Because they were first isolated from the birds in their bursa fabrica, so we call them as B cells. And these are the two types of cells which would be formed from a single progenitor cells. And they establish different, for example, the B cells, they would establish different colonies within the lymphoid tissues. Now all of these processes are occurring during the fetal life and early childhood. For example, a child born already would have developed the T cells, because much of the development takes place in the mid fetal life, or the early, for let's say the month of the baby, the life of the baby. So even if we remove the thymus after that time, still the baby is going to have the T cells because they have developed earlier. And similar is for the B cells. Now what happens that after early childhood, most from the peripheral lymphocyte colonies, they form activated T and B lymphocyte. That is the distinction into early and early fetal life and then early childhood. Now where does the pre-processing of a single progenitor cells occur? That is in the T, it is in the thymus gland that pre-processes T lymphocytes, therefore the name T is given. And then the B lymphocytes, which were first isolated from the bursa of Fabricius in birds, therefore given the name B lymphocytes, it usually pre-processes in liver and bone marrow. So remember, the B for bone marrow and B for B lymphocytes, T for thymus, and then T lymphocytes. So it will be easy for you to memorize this. Now from this diagram, you can see the formation of antibodies and the sensitized lymphocytes by lymph nodes in response to antigens. So you can see a common lymphoid progenitor cells, then they are from if it goes and migrates into thymus, then it is going to form the T lymphocytes. And if it develops within the bone marrow, it usually forms a B lymphocyte. And this B lymphocytes is then, for example, after antigenic exposure, it is going on to develop plasma cells. And these plasma cells then develop different types of different classes of antibodies. And if the similar exposure of the T lymphocytes to the antigen, it is going to form activated T lymphocyte. This activated T lymphocytes are further of different types and have different functions. So this is called as a cell mediated immunity. The T, because in this the whole cell becomes activated, so this is called as cell mediated immunity. And this is called as the humoral immunity because the B cell in itself is not activated as a whole to destroy bacteria. Rather, it forms different other cells, for example, plasma cells, which forms antibodies and which are further implicated in destruction of the antigen. Now, the lymphoid tissue were not only present within the bone marrow, so it can be, these are different areas which has been, in this diagram you can see, which can act as a lymphoid tissue. Besides lymph nodes and bone marrow, you have spleen, you have Peyer's patches, you have certain areas of your GI tract, for example, the appendix. You have the thymus, and then you have the adenoid and the tonsils. Now, these are also lymphoid, you can consider them as lymphoid tissue. Now, this is very important. Millions of specific types of lymphocytes are stored within the lymphoid tissues. There are a lot, millions and millions of them. But all the different lymphocytes that are capable of forming one specificity of antibody or T cell is called a clone of lymphocyte. For example, if there are millions of lymphocytes present, but of these millions, for example, they are each specific to a specific antigen. And for a specific antigen, they would form a group of lymphocytes which would be specific for only that antigen. And this is called as clone of lymphocyte. For example, a clone of cells are formed specific to fight a specific antigen. It is not for example, there is antigenic exposure to your body and all of the millions of lymphocytes would come into play and just would start fighting. No, this does not happen. It selects a specific lymphocyte, and a specific lymphocyte have a specific receptors for that antigens, and a specific clone of lymphocytes would be formed, and this clone would be specific for, let's say, antigen 1, you have a different clone of lymphocyte. For antigen 2, you have different clone of lymphocytes. So this depends upon the antigen as well as the clone of the lymphocyte. Now, this is the sequence in which all these processes are occurring. For example, you have dormant lymphocyte. Dormant means that it's not active. It's just lying over there. Then the second process is invasion of the body by foreign antigen. For example, an antigen comes into an action. And for a substance to be antigenic, it usually have a high molecular weight, about 8,000 or greater. So, and these antigens, they usually have reoccurring molecular groups, which are called as epitopes on the surface of these large molecules. So, this would explain why different proteins and large molecules are almost always antigenic. Because for an antigen to be called antigen, it must have a bigger size, it must have a larger size, it must have a molecular weight greater than or at least equal to 8,000. And then these antigens, they have specific reoccurring epitopes which are being recognized by your lymphocytes. So there were dormant lymphocytes just sleeping there. But then what happened? There was invasion of the body by a specific antigen. What would these lymphocytes do? They would not be just lying there and sleeping. They would come into action. They would phagocytosis. Phagocytosis means eating up of these bacteria. They would just eat, they would be eaten up by different macrophages which are already circulating in your system. And these macrophages, they are called as antigen presenting cells. For example, the antigen was there, they ate up that bacteria with the antigen. Now they have this antigen and they are going to present this antigens to the lymphocyte. So that a lymphocyte is now going to do whatever is necessary for it. So they are going to present this antigen to the lymphocytes. There are different types of antigen presenting cells, for example macrophages, dendritic cells, and certain B lymphocytes can also act as antigen presenting cells. They have that, they after eating the bacteria they have taken hold of that antigenic part, and then they go and they present it to different lymphocytes so that they are going to develop proper responses against that invading organism. Now, what is an antigen? An antigen is a substance that can induce an immune response. So, what is an antigen? Any substance that is not going to induce an immune response but of greater molecular weight, it would not be called an antigen. So, anything that is inducing the immune response, and when introduced into an immunocompetent host, immunocompetent means anybody whose immune system is viable, it works. We have certain individuals who are immunodeficient, that is, they are deficient on their immune system. These are the very old people, these are the very young, the one, for example, the babies, and then the aged persons, and then there are certain diseases which makes you immunodeficient. So if any molecule that are going to induce an immune response in an immune competent host and can react with the antibody produced from the response, so that would be antigen. Now, what happens in the bone marrow? We said that we have a common progenitor cells from where we form a pre-T cell and a pre-B cell. The pre-T cell is in the thymus, and after the different processes of maturation, they form T cells, and the pre-B cells usually in the bone marrow. Or in the liver, and after processes of maturation they form the B cell. Now these are the adult T cell and the active B cells. What happens, the T cells can further be, there are a lot of other T cells, but for the safe for our lecture over here we just be confining to these T cells, the T8 suppressor cell or the T4 helper cell. These two are important because they help in your immunity by influencing the B cell. That's why I'm mentioning them over here. So the T4 cell, it becomes activated. I told you the T cell in itself gets activated, and then it goes and fights the bacteria, and whatever the antigenic the antigenic part it would go the T4 cell, and it is going to present it to the B cell and would help the B cell form more of the plasma cells. Now, it would help the B cells to become activated. That's why they are called as the helper T cell, that after fighting the bacteria of the virus would take that information and go on to activate more B cells. The B cells would of course follow a system. Whenever there is antigenic exposure, it is going to become activated, and it is going to secrete plasma cells, and the plasma cells are going to secrete different antibodies. But the role of the T cell, T4 cell, is that after it is also going, when it is excited, it is further going to help the B cells so that this response is much more magnified, much more stronger, as would be only the B cell in action if there was absent T4 cells. So the immunity would not be that proper. Now there are T8 suppressor cells which would either act by suppressing the T4 cells, that okay, you have done your work, and now no more work is needed, so they are going to suppress it. So first of all, coming to the humoral immunity and antibodies that is pertaining to your B lymph. Now coming here again, for how the antibodies are formed by the plasma cells. So this is the relevant you can see sequence in which antibodies are formed. We have done this, for example, the dormant B lymphocytes lying there in the lymphoid tissue. Then comes the antigen in action. There is exposure and antigen to the B lymphocytes. Macrophages play a role in activation of this process. How? The macrophages, I told you, after phagocytosing, they are going to become the antigen presenting cells to the B cells. And the helper T cells also contribute in this activation by further activating the B cell. They go on and they activate the process. The process is already activated, rather they would help up in further fastening the process of formation of more and more antibodies. So the sequence of the events of how the antibodies are formed, we have the B lymphocytes, they enlarge to form the lymphoblast. So this would be the first cell. And then from the lymphoblast, it proliferates and differentiates into different cells, but the end result is the formation of plasma blast. Now the plasma blast, the mature of these, they are also called as antibody factories, because they are making different types of antibodies, which are gamma globulins. Now formation of memory cells is what is the difference between primary and secondary response. Now what are these memory cells? So a few of the lymphoblasts formed by activation of a clone of the beta the B lymphocyte, sorry, do not go on to form the plasma cells. For example, we said the lymphoblast, they go on to form the plasmoblast and then they form the plasma cells. No, all of them do not form the plasma cells, but instead some of the lymphoblasts, they will not form plasma cells, and they will form moderate numbers of new B lymphocytes, which are similar to the original clone of the lymphocyte. Now, in other words, the B cell population of the specifically activated clones becomes greatly enhanced, and new B lymphocytes are added to the original lymphocytes. And they also circulate throughout the body and populate all of your lymphoid tissue from wherever your cells are coming. So, and they would also remain dormant. For example, they have been formed, but they go, for example, they have been kept in the lymphoid tissue, they would just be sitting there. Now, if the second time the antigen comes into the action, these lymphocytes, they already recognize these antigens because they have been exposed first to them, and they have that information, and these are called as memory cells. So now formation of the memory cell is the only difference between what we call as primary response and secondary response to an infection. Now you can easily see this in this diagram. For example, you have first exposure to the antigen. You can see you just have two of these cells, activated cells, which have been formed. But second exposure to the antigen, because there are a lot of formation of the memory cells, and these memory cells, they have done what? They have formed new clones of these B cells, and they have been sitting in your lymphoid tissue. So you will get a lot of activated cells because the information was already there. If you put this into a graph, you can see the blue is for the primary response. This was the first response that you got. Formation of the antibodies was there, and you can see that on the x-axis you have time, on the y-axis you have concentration of the antibodies. So in which of these graphs do you see do you find out more formation of antibodies? This is in the secondary one. You can see that in the secondary one, the a lot of antibodies are there. For example, if I can give you an example from in nowadays, what we are doing is vaccination for coronavirus. So with the first injection, this would happen. For example, antibodies would be formed, but not on that greater account. We have introduced that antigen, and that antigen is the virus, that is the coronavirus. So the body is going to start producing antibodies against that virus, and some of the cells, for example, the memory cells are formed. They have been distributed through all the lymphoid tissue. Now on the second dose, what would happen? A lot of immunity develops, and your antibodies, they are going to peak and remain there for a longer period of time. So this is the difference between the primary and the secondary response, is the formation of memory cells. Now this is a structure, a typical structure of an antibody. You can remember the classes of the antibodies by a mnemonic called GAMED. G-A-M-E-D, GAMED. So these five types of antibodies you must remember, and you must remember their function. Now a typical antibody have heavy chains that are denoted in boldly by this brown one, and a light chain that is by this light brown one. And you can see these are the antigen binding sites where the antigen would be binding consists of both a heavy chain and a right chain. This is also called as the FAP fragment, and this is the constant portion, which is also called as the FC fragment. Now you must know these FC fragment and antibody binding fragment, that is FAP fragment, when we are further doing different types of antibodies and how these antibodies then further produce on physiological functions. So each antibody, we said that these are gamma globulins, and these are also called as immunoglobulins. If you come, we call them as IG. IG means immunoglobulin, so that's why they have been abbreviated. And they have molecular weight somewhere around 160,000 to 970,000. And they usually constitute these antibodies about 20% of your plasma proteins. So all of these immunoglobulins, they have light chain and heavy chain. And most of them are a combination of two heavy chains and two light chains, as shown here in this structure. But then you can have an antibody which can have up till 10 light chains and 10 heavy chains. It can be a combination of that. Yet all immunoglobulins have heavy chain. In all immunoglobulins, heavy chain is parallel to the light chain at one of its ends, thus forming a heavy light chain pair. No matter if there is a combination of two, a combination of four, a combination of five, a combination of 10, but this would always be a combination of one light and a heavy chain, which are parallel to one another. Now this you can see is a IgM antibody, and you can see how many it is also called as pentamer because it has 5 sites, and at these 5 sites it can bind different antigens, right? So for different antibodies you have different combination of these light and heavy chains. Now each antibody is specific for a particular antigen. For example, IgM would be specific for particular, IgA has its own work, IgM has its own work. It doesn't, it has its unique structure. And this unique structure is because of the organization of different amino acids that have different shape for different antigens. So when the antibody is highly specific, there are so many binding sites that the antigen-antibody coupling can take place, and which can help them be stronger, to be held together stronger, either by hydrophobic binding or by hydrogen binding or by ionic interactions or by van der Waals forces. You have gone through these concepts in your physics, if you remember from your FSC. These are the different type of interactions by which an antigen-antibody coupling can occur, and it depends upon different antigenic site. So when defining the specificity of the antibodies, we say that we have a numeral that is called as Ka constant, that is affinity constant, which would be a fraction of concentration of the bound antibody. For example, in this it is bound to an antigen. So a bound antigen-antibody complex divided by concentration of the antibody alone and the concentration of the antigen alone. So affinity constant is basically how much of your antigen-antibody are bound, relevant to the ratio of how much they are present alone, both antigen and antibody. So this is called as the affinity constant. Now different types of antibodies and its different functions. For example, IgG usually has 80% of the total. It usually crosses the placenta. So whatever the immunity mother is developing, it would cross through the placenta to the baby. And the baby is also going to have that immunity. And it usually causes opsonization. Now this what is opsonization? That is marking of these invading organisms with certain type of molecules so as to make them more palatable for the immune system to degrade. Then you have IgM antibodies. They are usually first produced whenever an invading organisms come into action. They are usually 10 to 15% of the total, and they usually form the active complement system. So whenever there is an invading organism, for example, the first antibody to come into your stream would be IgM antibody. And the second antibody that would be after the primary response, the second antibody that would be there would be IgG antibody, which would remain for a prolonged period of time. For example, somebody having been infected with a virus, for example, let's say coronavirus or its tuberculosis or typhoid. So if we have a positive IgM antibodies, it means that actively infection is taking place. This is the first response. But if we have a lot of IgG antibodies, then we would assume that the patient had that infection in the past and now has developed immunity against it. Now we have IgD antibodies. Not much is known about this type of antibody. But it may help the CD4 cells, the helper cells. Then we have IgA antibody, usually in all, it is present in all the body fluids, tears, bronchial secretions and saliva. And then we have IgE antibodies, which are usually implicated on allergic reactions. For example, if you had allergy to something, so the first antibody to appear would be IgE antibodies. Now, what is the mechanism? We are done with the concepts of what is immunity, what are antigens, what are antibodies, then different type of immunity. We did with the T-cell immunity, we did with the humoral immunity, and then the different lymphoid tissues where these cells are sitting on and would respond. Then we did different clones of lymphocytes which were specific against a specific antigen, and then they would respond to it. And then we did the different degrees of development and maturations of B cell and T cell. And then how B cell and how T cell acts, they are key constituents in our immune system, and how they bring about these changes. The B cells usually bring about these changes by production of antibodies and memory cells, and the T cell usually by activated whole of the T cell. And there are a lot of T cells, some would just go on and kill these bacteria, and some are going to help the B cell to further make this immune response more powerful. So now, how does these antibodies, then we did antibodies. What are antibodies? Now, why do we call them as they have Ig for immunoglobulin? There are different classes of antibodies and there are different functions of antibodies. Now, how does these antibodies, they bring about their functions? For example, what is the mechanism of action of these antibodies? So we have direct action of the antibodies or the complement system. So directly, how can an antibody how can it invade, how can it help in invading agents? So it can help it through four processes. So number one would be agglutination. That is, in which multiple large particles with antigens on their surfaces, such as bacteria or the cell, they are formed into a clump. That agglutination means to coagulate, that they would be formed into a clump. So this is the first method in which directly an antibody would just go and coagulate that particle. Then the second one would be precipitation, in which the molecular complex of soluble antigen and antibody becomes so large that is, it is rendered insoluble and it precipitates. So if it precipitates, it becomes inactive. Then we can have neutralization, in which antibodies, what they do, they would cover the toxic sites of antigenic agent. So they are neutralized. And then this, the end, if a bacteria or invading organism cannot be agglutinated, cannot be precipitated, cannot be neutralized, then the antibodies, they just have one more last action left, and that is lysis, in which the antibodies, they occasionally, they are capable of directly attacking the membranes of the invading organism and causing rupture of that agent, causing lysis. So these are the mechanism by which directly an antibody can act. And then the second is the complement system. The complement system is initiated by an antigen-antibody reaction. For example, there is an antigen, an antibody comes and binds to it. Now this complex antigen-antibody binding it activates the complement system, which has three types. So now the direct action, we said that it can be done by agglutination, then it can also be done by precipitation, precipitating the invading organism, neutralizing the invading organism, and if none of these three are capable, then lysis. Now you can see here by this diagram, you have an antigen antibody complex. Now what happens if this fixes on the different body tissues or different cells? So it is going to activate the complement system. Okay, and if it is and this antigen and antibody complex, if directly worked on by the antibodies, can cause neutralization. This is how the neutralization, for example, these are the active sites of these virus or a bacteria. So what would happen, that these would be neutralized, the active sites, antibodies are going to attach and they are going to be neutralized. Now this is how agglutination would occur. They are going to form a coagulum. Precipitation, it would usually call them a lot of these complexes are formed, and after these are formed, what happens, that they can they are no more soluble now, so they are rendered insoluble. So now when this agglutination can further go on, if it is enhanced, it would go on in end up in a process called as phagocytosis. Now phagocytosis means eating up the green ones. You can see these are the bacteria or the invading organism, the viruses, so they will be eaten up by these cells. So this is called the process of phagocytosis. And then you have, by the complement system, what the complement system can do, by an antigen antibody complex is formed and it fixes on to certain tissues, it also leads to either the phagocytosis or the inflammation or the cell lysis. The end result is the same, either it is done directly or it is done indirectly, and the end result is the cell lysis, the inflammation process, aggravation of the inflammation process. So a lot of cells are going into that and the chemotaxis, by the method of chemotaxis, and they are going to go there, gather around the virus or the bacteria, and then aid in the process of removing that agent from your body. Now what is a complement system? Just a brief explanation over here. We will be doing a more detailed lecture. It is a series of 20 or more proteins, and these are activated by microorganisms. These proteins are usually formed in your liver, and they are roaming here and there, and they get activated if there is an antigen. Now this is some these are the different proteins which we call as C proteins, complement proteins, which are formed by your liver, which are present or circulating within your system. And they become activated if there is an antigen antibody complex is formed, and it causes activation process. Now functions of the complement system, what are the functions of the complement system? Function is to kill the bacteria, lysis, to cause chemotaxis, to attract the attention to the area of inflammation by phagocytosis, and opsonization. Opsonization means marking of these bacteria. You can see these are bacteria, then marking of these bacteria so as to make them more delicious for the macrophages to eat them up. For example, you are eating a bread, a plain bread, it would not be that tasty, but if you put a Nutella spread on it, and then of course you are making it more palatable, more delicious to eat. So similar is the process of opsonization, making these bacteria more delicious for the macrophages to eat them up. So you can see this is the process of opsonization. This is a bacteria, and it has been marked with certain antibodies, and they have been now this bacteria is it has a specific receptors to this Fc portion. And now it is going to be more palatable for it to be opsonized, or it has been more become more attractive. Thank you guys. So see you again in the next slide, the next presentation, that would be on the complement system. we have done in briefly different aspects of antigen antibody system, and you already know now what is complement system. We just do certain physiological features later on. Thank you.